for example, you have lots of inquiries, so it's not harder to write some products, and it's not a quality of everything you've done, it's worse and worse, and I feel, for me, it's really easy to see that water is changing, the quality of water is much worse than it was before. So, it's really going to be much seen every month, it's much, much.
Stuff on this, maybe not because the you read about it a lot, that the situation changed, that people moved, but not all of them, because not all of them have some place to go. Or I remember a show, great movies made by our friend from Austria, Natasha Gumino, from the Eastern Ukraine, and you know, she saw the lots of totally destroyed the people in a really difficult situation, and that's what you said. I think this is one of the first problems, that this humanitarian crisis is something that you think it started or it will start, and what people are telling about this situation.
Well, for me, the most horrible situation was in the Balsama. I was there about, it was about 2 months ago. So, firstly, I was on the Ukrainian side, I saw how it's looking. The bots at the moment was still under control of Ukrainian forces. It was in January. And at this moment, people were living in basements. There was about 5,000 people there. They're living in basements. They have a problem with getting food. They had some humanitarian aid, but still, it was not enough. But many of them don't want to leave this place. I was in the months of more than a month after this, after January, it was, February, and there was about 2,000 people. They were living under shame, really heavy shame. I even don't know how to explain how heavy was this shame. It was really serious war. There was all the time working heavy artillery almost all day from both sides. And these people were living in really bad conditions. I saw kids, 2 years kids, who were living in these basements. And I don't know why, but parents don't want to leave this place. They were saying that it's our land, but we cannot, we even don't imagine how to live on other territories. So we want to stay. And they really don't care about, maybe they don't care, but they were. More want to say they need house, they home, than their life. For me, it was really, really unbelievable that people can be so afraid to live on their territory and don't want to move because they don't see any perspectives for them. They are believing that the Donbas is all of their life, that the place they were born, they were born, and right now they are living. So they are. Even if it's heavy shell, they want to stay there.
If you talk with these people, like what they tell about this political situation, what it means for them that little green people came, what it means for them to be a part of Ukraine, and they think about this, what they say about this situation, what they, in this everyday like conversation.
Well, it's really changing because I first came to Donbass that April last year, and every month I hear something other. That at the beginning it was mostly federalization, people were thinking, yeah, we want to be a part of Ukraine, we want to have more laws and be more independent from Kyiv. Then it started to change in the separatist movement, and then people started talking that we want to be a part of Russia, or we want to be a part, or we want to be an independent country. Others still were talking about federalization. So it's It's really hard to know what really people were thinking, because we don't have any researches about this, we don't have any posts, and nobody cannot do any good sociological research, because it's really hard to work next to it. So a lot of people were supporting and still are supporting the so-called Donetsk People's Republic and separatists, because they're believing that right now they're doing their own life, they're doing their own history, and they're feeling that they're really important right now, but it's not all different. I remember the Nets at April, where were pro-Ukrainian demonstrations. It was, I remember, a few thousand people there. They weren't smaller than pro-Russian demonstrations. So there was a big part of people who were supporting Ukraine. But I don't know, they lose this life, maybe. I don't know, it's a good word, but other sides started using really fastly a lot of violence. On the streets started going patrols with maybe not the first moment, not with a gun, but it's really starting to be dangerous. It was first victims and then starting to, not only demonstration, but starting to be occupied. But they started to take control over all cities. So yeah, so it was all the time changing. But a lot of people still is supporting separatists.
And also when you talk with the people, do they have, because you said, and it's really interesting also in the book that you're telling people don't want to move, but they also cannot imagine that they could live somewhere else. They cannot imagine. It's also really difficult if you have a family with kids. You just leave your everything you have and just move somewhere without any support. And do they think that Russia can be a supporter for them, or do they think, as you said, like, maybe not, I don't know, Europe or the European Union, but they think that I don't know, who could be the partner who can support, for example, rebuilding the city, because the city, the houses are destroyed, the cities are destroyed. Who will take care of this? Do people think about it, or do people see any perspective who could support them in this? They believe that it will be Russia?
Not really, because nobody had any idea who would build the city. Everybody is really, for example, it's the Balzer, I don't know how many buildings are destroyed or heavy damage. But I think really big percent, maybe half, maybe more, maybe less, I don't know. But people really don't know who would do it. They don't believe that Russia can do it. They don't believe that separatists do it, and they don't believe that Ukraine do it. They are only trying to live in this condition. They don't have any idea what to do. So I don't know who they're responsibility for this, but I don't see anybody who wants to do it right now.
And it's like, are people, like,
Russian
people follow this meetings, the political conversation between Putin and Angela Merkel and Hollande? Do they, if they follow, if they know that there are some kind of conversation about them, like, without them, is it, like, important for them, or is it, like, is it too far from their everyday problem and they don't think it really can change something?
Yeah, I remember one thing they called me in Slovensk, in April, and they asked me what people are thinking about peace talks in general. And I really don't know what to answer, because people don't know what's going on in Kyiv or somewhere else. They really don't have any idea what's going on there. Mm-hmm. What about taking this fallout and Merkel? Someone was asking me about what is thinking Mr. Sikorsky, what they think about Mr. Sikorsky, who was at this moment Minister of Foreign Policy. Many people don't know anything about this. It's really, they're drinking really a lot. They don't know what's going on in global politics. Maybe only one of their thinking that's a clash of kind of civilization. But there is a fight between the USA or NATO or the European Union. with Russia. That they're only a victim of this, they're really a victim of this. What I'm saying that the people are believing, we still must remember that it's a big part of people who are moved from the past to other regions, but they were living and they're not thinking the same. So it's always when I'm talking about general opinion or maybe a big part or supporters of DNR, I don't know how to call them, but it's not all Donbass. We must remember that there is not one Donbass, there is not another region. So please do remember this.
Yeah, of course, like if we talk about this situation, we talk in some general ideas and also in general, because you met people who were there, but you also met the journalists. You also have this, you're in a situation that you can go to Kiev, you can come back to Poland, you can meet with other journalists, and you can also follow the debate, like international debate about the situation. So what the journalists when you are going from one city to another by cab and you have this 1 hour, 2 hour when you talk, how do people from other countries see the situation?
Depends. Mostly in general they are seeing that something is going wrong, that maybe a similar view to me. Many journalists with many views, so it's really hard to say who is speaking what, because they can talk with you and in other words saying something other. So I really don't know. I maybe don't want to talk about other journalists because you know it's we talk a lot, but many of them is more pro Ukrainian, other pro Russian. I don't know. I know guys from Western media, I know guys from Russian media, or even I met some from separatist media, so they have really. I think it's the same really more polarization like between people in Donbass and people in Ukraine. That some of them are they are more for Ukraine, and they are more for Russia, and more for separatists.
If you'd like to join into this discussion.
Thank you. It's a question of the Nazi insignia used by Italians. How do they explain to you why they are using them? The Volkswagen, SS, Panzer Division, and so on. What is the answer? And who is financing? How do they think about Kolomoisky, using his money to support this battalion's idea and ask him, how the situation is perceived by Donbass people, by Kiev people, by Romanian people? You know, it's something for me. I don't want to blame anybody. Something like this. I cannot understand it. Why European Union is giving money to this anti-terrorist operation when officially the battalion Azov has a false flag on the logo. So something in 21st century, after Nuremberg, is not singing very well, you know, altogether. I can understand that some people are not aware. They are young, that you don't know what's going on. I cannot explain, and maybe you can help me.
Yeah, there are obviously some guys who are believing that they are Nazis, so they are saying that they are Nazis. And I don't know why Ukrainian government is allowed to put a Volkswagen on battalion, on one of those battalions. But still, war is always a time when there are really many radicals. There are one side and the other side. That's a problem, that there are much more foreign media in Ukraine, on the Ukrainian side, and less on the separatist side. So I saw a lot of guys who, I even saw a Russian journalist with black sun on his so always at the time of the war, we have chauvinistic, racist organizations. They are, that's obvious. And they are on the both sides. So I really don't like it. And maybe that's the reason why I really don't like war. That is the time for guys who like military stuff, who like to be, who want to be strong and show that the strength is only one group. But still, on the Ukrainian side, it's a kind of, I don't know how big percent, but it's not big. Even in Azerbaijan, I talked with them. Many of them are, most of them, there are people who want to fight, and they joined Azerbaijan because they want to fight, and they even don't imagine what this sign means. I'm not saying it's good or bad, but I talked with them, and many of them say, "No, I'm not fascist. Why are you thinking so?" So only a core of Azerbaijan started from a kind of political view, but right now a lot of people there. Fighting because they want to fight. They want to. They want to serve for the country, and they have no idea what to do. It's maybe the same example like in Poland with Warsaw independent, when a lot of people joining the far right movement, but they are not far right. They want to show their patriots. It's really strange because they are kind of doing kind of legitimization of these guys, but they are not the supporters. And I think something the same. For example, because in other battalions we don't have any Nazi symbols. I didn't see them even in the right sector. I'm saying about local type of battalions or something like this, or the official symbols. There are some people there who are they own views and they're saying, yeah, we're for right, we're left. But I met even guys in the same battalion that I know who is saying that I'm left, he's radical left. So in the one group, because in battalions with smaller groups, smaller units, you can meet guys from far right and from the far left, they are checking with each other. Because they are saying, we have right now other goals than fight with each other. When war ends, we are starting to check with each other, fighting with each other, but right now we are fighting with our common enemy. So yeah, it's, for me it's often really unbelievable, but it's all situation truly unbelievable. So in these conditions I don't to blame anybody. I try to understand this really. It's hard to me, I still don't understand this. But I'm not in a war, I'm not a soldier, I'm a journalist who going there for 3 weeks, going back to Kyiv or to Warsaw. Maybe if I sit there for 3 months or 5 months all the time, I start to understand this. But still, I don't understand. What about Komorowski? He was supporting, and maybe he's still, probably he's supporting few battalions. No, I don't know about Azerbaijan. He's probably financing Dnipro 1, whatever, but we don't have any. I can say that it's a fact because we don't have any proof that he's giving the money. You know how it works. But probably he's a Dnipro battalion and other battalions. I'm not sure about Azerbaijan. I think he's supported by other religions, but I don't know. I cannot say for sure. So.
He took not.
No, not Pinchuk. Pinchuk is financed right now, Pinchuk and Center. So, so it's not so risky. I think this is far better. So, it's great, but it is what we must remember that at the beginning of this war, there was really no Ukraine. I mean, after we had COVID, there was only a few thousand people, and so army was in really bad condition. And this army is right now rebuilding. They are rebuilding army, and that's the reason why there are so many volunteers, because there was no army, and someone must fight. So we saw battalion in Bas, we saw battalion in Ukraine, battalion Azov, Aida, and many other right sector even. They want to do something, because government in Kyiv wasn't doing anything in the first moment. You must remember that at the first stage, anti-terrorist operation was. It really wasn't working. They came with some ABCs, and soldiers don't want to fight because they don't want to do. They don't have any orders. They don't know what to do, and separatists take control over the ABCs, and these guys have to go. So these volunteers saw that state is not working, army is not working, so we have to do something. And I think that's obvious that far right will be a big part. Some parts of this. Who want to do something because it's their political goal to do something by strength or power. So I think it's not strange. More important would be what Kyiv will do with these guys. If it's still what they will do with symbolic and other stuff. Yeah, it's kind of risk, and maybe it will be dangerous in in some planet. Right now it's strange, but not dangerous.
Are there other questions?
I have two questions. You mentioned that there's no, of course, as we know, public opinion poll in the moment in the separatist areas. But I wonder whether you could confirm or say something about the public mood you could observe. I read many media reports in international press pointing out that since the money flow stopped to the east from Kiev, for salaries, pensions, and so on, the mood has changed quite a lot against Kiev. Not necessarily pro-Russian, but against the central government in Kiev. Could you confirm this and how you see this danger of something developing out of this effect? And my second question to the public opinion in Ukraine, in the non-separatist areas in the West, do you see the danger in the middle and the long run that a feeling might prevail, okay, if these guys in the East favor Russia or are against us, why not let them go? Why pay for them? Why care for them? So do you see the danger of a general tendency of a separatist feeling in the West arguing, okay, don't have too much in common. Not now, of course, but in a couple of years.
But do you mean other regions of Western Ukraine? Or
yeah, yeah, of course.
Okay, so firstly about... I cannot confirm this really. I was maybe too short in the Donetsk right now to confirm this, but I think the people when they are... Yeah, they're really tired. That I think the most often I'm hearing that we are really tired, we want to stop war, and even we don't care who will be ruling us, or it will be Russia, it will be separatists, it will be Ukraine, we want to have that fight to stop the war. And I don't know this kind of policy. For me, it's looking strange that they are doing this kind of... they are not allowing everybody to go to territories under control of Ukrainian control. And there is a problem with salaries, with pensions, and everything like that. Yeah, for me it's strange because people are suffering. That's true, but I don't know how to solve this problem. I don't know how to do it. I don't like it. Yeah, but it's my private opinion. About moods in other regions, I think it's stable right now. I think the most dangerous is this kind of terrorist acts that I mean, that there are exploding bombs, there are a lot of people, some people died in Kharkiv, for example, and in Odessa, and situations in this sense are stable that somebody is provoking. These my friends who were in Odessa, a few months ago or even a few weeks ago, they thought that mood really changed in that sense that people, they were really from Ukraine. Right now they want to quiet, to stop the war and stop the situation, to live in a stable and quiet city. So that's changing very.
Questions?
Okay, so you've been to several places in Donbass, I guess, and I would like to ask you, are those people who live, for example, in some margin parts of Donetsk district, more related to more supporting Ukrainian side than, for example, to compare with Donetsk itself?
Yeah, I thought in the beginning, for example, for me, it was the reason why I chose Slovensk, for example, Slovensk, because it was much easier to convince these people to the idea where is a big unemployment, where is a big, really bad condition of life, and you have really no perspective. So you are feeling that from Kyiv is going something bad. Maybe will be some scary nationalist or something, I don't know what. I think it was much easier to convince us in the small cities. For example, I will in Torez, in Snizhne, in Shakhtarsk,
here.
And I don't know, Krasny Łódź, Czesk, Krasnodon, there never was a
big cities, which was really perspective and had the chance to do a career or in a really good way. So yeah, I think the kind of idea that we'll be independent, we won't be giving money to Kyiv, but we'll be living on our own, because the people are thinking that they're giving more money to Kyiv, they got back. That's not true. But they were believing that when they stopped giving money to Kyiv, the Kyivs started to push pressure on them, they started to live in a better way. But it was really false, because they are still getting more. They were getting more from Kyiv than they gave it. So really, Kyiv was giving a lot of money to them. So it's. I think it's a result of propaganda that they start to believe in this, that they are producing food for all Ukraine. They believe in this, but it's not true. We see it's really good that there is no products and shops in Donbass. But in Kyiv there are still, you can buy everything, and it's produced in Ukraine, no, not in Donbass. So yeah, so it's, for me, it's really a result of propaganda that we started to believe in this. But it was, for me, it was much easier to manipulate people who are in bad conditions, who often didn't travel anywhere, even they don't leave their oblast, the region. A lot of, I don't know how many percent of visits, but I met a lot of people who never left Donbass. So for them, it was their own world that they were living, and for them it was really the best thing what they can find in their life. So idea of independence, it was proud, it was good. They can change their way of life.
Okay, thanks.
Do you think there is a risk in other regions in Eastern Ukraine, like in Kharkiv or in Dnipropetrovsk, for another region to start or another series of riots that may result in the extension of the area of the separatists and Russian military action?
Yeah, I think only the Russia can, or some groups try to make situation unstable, maybe in Odessa, maybe try in Kharkiv. But that's all. I really, the moods in these regions are much more other than in the past. So I don't believe that Ukraine can really start work. Maybe it could be, I don't know, kind of a military operation did by Russia. One thing which I think it's possible to really destabilize situation in this region.
Mario?
Mariupol for me is a bit media panic, because it's really good city with really good defense. There's a few lines of defense right now. There is a lot of artillery close to Mariupol, so if you start any attack from separatist side, they can to defend the city. I think it's too risky for separatists to attack Mariupol. You need to have really a lot of tanks, a lot of units to do it. Right now, I think it's maybe not impossible, but really hard to do, and it will cost a lot of victims. So probably separatists will go further for me, or the way to Kramatorsk Soviet, or try to get Shchastya, which is here. And I think that's a more possible direction than Mariupol. Mariupol, it was really media panic, because everybody was starting, okay, what after the Baltic? It must be Mariupol, because it would be land way to Crimea. And everybody is still talking in media about land way to Crimea, but it's almost impossible. It would must, I don't know, we probably need to have their half or all Russian army to get control over this, because it's really hard territory to go there, and even the woods are much other than in Donbass. So I think it's right now really hard, but after Crimea, for me, everything is possible.
I would like to also connect this meeting, which is much more Ukrainian for beginners, maybe, with Poland for beginners. How you can see the situation in Poland, like the discussion about the Ukraine is changing? Because you can see this Also, you can compare this with the situation before the war and before the Maidan. When you started to write about Ukraine, you said this at the beginning, and I also remember that no one cares. Like, this is a neighbor, but honestly, no one cares. And how this situation has changed, and also how the debate is changing. Do you think during this few months that you can follow this, and also how the media are they much more interested? We of course understand that they are much more interested, and I think they call you much often than 1 year ago. But how also debate in Poland about the situation?
Right, I really think that you know better about the situation in Polish media because I'm mostly not reading Polish media. I'm reading. Sorry, but I think that you can correct me.
But you can, you know the question they asked. You can see that what was the question at the beginning and what are the questions now?
Maybe that's changed that my close family and my friends started asking me, so when will be war here? It's for me, my cousin asked me, she's a female, she asked me, well, I should go on a training how, because I don't know how to shoot. I know a first aid, maybe I start to, I know how, I want to know how to shoot from machine gun. Maybe it would be good for me. I was very shocked because I think a year ago or 2 years ago, thinking about going on a shooting range, it would be something unbelievable. But people started, I don't know, maybe they are afraid. They started to be afraid. Maybe you can thinking something out of it would be really interesting to me. Because really, I'm not reading Polish media, and I'm mostly reading everything that's going on in Ukraine and Russia and Western media. So I just really don't.
Absolutely. This is also the question that people ask us now, and there are some friends or people call him, Krytyka Polityczna, and they ask, what Krytyka Polityczna thinks about the war, nuclear war? It's really.
Are you answering, they're buying flak jackets?
Yeah, but this is a serious question now.
I have a question concerning German aesthetics. If you look at the Russian territory, for instance, we can see people who are on the front line in a very dangerous situation, risking their lives and at the same time serving life. How can you explain this? Are they so proud of being a soldier of information war, or do they really believe in what they are doing? So how can you explain? So have you seen the situation where people are risking their lives and at the same time doing something which is quite immoral? Or could you see it maybe from the Ukrainian side as well?
Well, that's a good question. I'd like to know an answer for this. I know about journalists who are, for example, taking gun in their hands. And for me, it's, I don't know, I have a few offers too from battalions, from soldiers. Oh, maybe you want to pose a machine gun. No, thank you, I'm a journalist. But a lot of people are taking guns, and they're doing it for Moscow. So, you know, for example, famous Graham Phillips, probably you heard about him. He's not a journalist anymore. He's going to training camps, he's wearing a camo, even he has this camouflage, snow camouflage. We saw a lot of videos when he's shooting, and I think it's not a journalist. So, yeah, there are people. What they're doing, I think, for example, Graham Phillips is believing in this. Because I met him a few times, and he's worse than programming media from Russia. He was, maybe not shouting, but starting to. Offending colleagues from Western media because they are thinking something other. They were pointing on guys on separatist blog posts and saying, these guys are lying, you should do something with them. He's really starting to be more than like a DNR or LNR agent than a journalist. But yeah, from the Ukrainian side, there are too, these kind of journalists who are more engaged into information war than into saying what's going on really about news. From Ukrainian side, I know there are some of them believing that they're doing a good job because they believe that they can win only by propaganda. And I think maybe some of, or even big percent of Russian journalists believe the same. Yeah. But I don't know, it's maybe about money, but nobody will say it.
You won't risk your life for money, it's too crazy in my opinion.
I don't know. I'm not doing this, it's hard to ask.
I mean, lately, Adam Michnik and General Brindle, there are thousands of Russian army tanks. And how we can have a proof still? There are echelon, there is satellite images, and so on. I think the stream never produced, or Pentagon never produced any proof. So, how can it be like?
I think it was 10,000 soldiers. But,
not soldiers, but tanks. I mean, tanks.
Okay, but I think I read about soldiers, but okay, I don't know. I'm not the spokesperson of meeting, so I.
And about
okay, maybe. I never heard about. I heard about 10,000 soldiers. Yeah, but it's really hard to get any confirmation, because we cannot have any confirmation in this world. Really, it's hard to. We don't know how many is victims, how many. We don't know nothing. You can ask me about any concrete statistics, and I will tell you. I don't know. I met some people who were talking, yeah, we are from Russia. Yeah, we have. I saw even a few passports of Russian guys, but they are not walking on the street and saying, hi, we're Russian soldiers. Maybe there are more of these guys in Luhansk. I met a few. When I was talking with guys in camouflage, they're saying, yes, we are from Russia. But yeah, it's hard to get confirmation. It's hard. You cannot go on the front line, go to the tank and ask, excuse me, where are you from? It's impossible. And so I met these guys. I met the locals too. So I know they're guys from my boss. How we present it from there? I don't know. How we present from Russia? I don't know. But yeah, but I remember the moment when it was, I think, July, when it really struck Ukraine offensive, and everybody was thinking that this conflict would end really fast because they separate two republics, and something was happening. Separatists got really a lot of artillery, heavy artillery. They won in Ilovaisk. They surrounded Ukrainian forces in Ilovaisk. Ukrainian forces left positions close to Luhansk, which was almost taken. It was. Northern part of the city was taken, and the city was surrounded only not from a south. In Novorossiysk appears about 30 miles, and that's the question, from where? Guys from Novorossiysk told me that they are going from Krasnodar, it's about 200 kilometers, and 140 was under control of Ukrainian forces. They must move close to the border on the Ukrainian side, 30 times. It's unbelievable to do it. So why states or anybody not publishing photos from there? I don't know.
So why you are talking about the Russian aggression when you cannot produce any proof? Any proof?
No, we have a lot of proof. We have a proof of soldiers who were there. We saw destroyed artillery, we saw destroyed tanks. So we have some. You can imagine that there is some group or big groups of Russian forces there, but you know how big it is. I don't know, I cannot confirm that it's 10,000, but it's a group of I don't know, grenades of Russian army.
And is it volunteers?
Maybe they are volunteers because it's really hard to.
Sorry, we have reports from Russia about funerals of ex soldiers or soldiers who clearly have been serving in Ukrainian camp as in coffins. So Russian journalists made this job to confirm this. So I mean, there is proof.
Yeah, there is a lot of proof. I think that.
But they can be still volunteers. Yeah, of course. Okay. In a coffin.
I mean, there's evidence that they persuade them to become volunteers, but of course they are in an official mission.
Okay, we don't believe that they are volunteers, but still there are volunteers tanks, volunteers guards.
Tanks, no photographs of tanks.
There was some symbolic of Russian tanks. So. Okay, but we can talk about this few hours. So I think
never crossed the border.
We have a question.
It's not a question, that's a really short. if somebody goes to the other side of the border, your Kamyanskyshahtinsky, Shakhty, Donetsk, the Russian side, they're obvious, there are tanks without size, so or like painted in green colors. These tactical marks of the tanks that are painted in green colors, there are tracks without registration plate going in the direction of the border. So everybody knows it, really.
But why UST never produced
I work with OSCE.
We are scientific academics.
And somehow OSCE is working, but they really cannot confirm anything. And they were, for example, on the planes of plane crash, with plane crash, and they cannot confirm anything. They say, we are not commenting anything because we are here to make conditions for people who will talk with each other, to make discussions about what's going on. So I saw how they are working, for example, on Ukrainian territories on the front line. They are coming somewhere, looking for half an hour, going back and right and there, starting sharing. And they cannot confirm anything because they are not on the place. Everybody knows, both sides know that they will come. So they are not sharing anything. Or even separatists saying, you cannot go there. You have no permission. I think they're saying, okay, you have no permission, you are not going there. So really OSCE, for me, it's the strangest organization. They didn't do anything still. I don't know. If you can say one or two classes of OSCE mission there, it would be great for me. I really love to hear it.
You said that you can tell a lot about how the debate works in Poland, but you are also very often in Kiev, not necessarily, but also in Kiev. And I think last time you have met in Kiev, not in Warsaw. And, and when you met with our friends, with your friends in Kiev, like, do you talk a lot about the situation? How do you see this?
Yeah, I think everybody is talking about the situation. Maybe they often try to forget about it, but they cannot. There's a lot of people trying to help, or to civilians, or to Ukrainian army. There are all the time, there are some people who are fighting on the front coming to Kyiv, so we are meeting each other. So yeah, we really have to forget about this. There is a lot of volunteers who are all the time going to the bus to try to help in some way. I remember in the Maltsev there was volunteers from Kyiv who are organizing evacuation of people from the bus. So it wasn't the state's job, it was the volunteers' job. But they mostly did the evacuation from the bus. So yeah, people are trying to help doing this. I was in Lviv and people are carrying tea. So people are trying to help, trying to solve, maybe they think that a good way or believing that would be a good way, trying to do something. What they can do the best. Some are only giving money, some are volunteers, some are journalists who are going on the front line trying to inform what's going on. So people are carrying food.
If you would like to also, like, you know, not just asking questions, but also joining the discussion.
I just wanted to make two points in respect to the question about Russian involvement. there are clearly very, very strong evidence that the Russians are involved. I can only give you two examples. First, for me, the most important fact is that the Russians don't allow OSCE observers to check the border between Ukraine and the separatist areas and Russia. So why do they do this? If they want to confirm that they are not involved, they are not sending hardware over the border, they would immediately say, please come and check. The second evidence for me is watching a television debate in German television, where the Russian and the Ukrainian ambassador were involved. The Russian ambassador was asked, but where does this hardware come from? From heaven or from where? And he was impudent enough to say, maybe the separatists bought them from corrupt Ukrainian officers. And the Ukrainian ambassador said immediately, but the kind of hardware we saw was never in the property of the Ukrainian army. We didn't have these big guns and these new tanks. we never had. And the Russian ambassador couldn't answer anything. I mean, this was for me very, very clear that there's no chance from the Russian side to deny that they are at least sending military hardware. As far as the soldiers are concerned, there is no evidence who they are, whether they are out of duty or volunteers or so. But as far as the military hardware is concerned, I think there's no doubt.
So I would like to ask you, what are your plans right now? When you went back, when you're going to Ukraine?
Yeah, I hope I will be in Donbass at the beginning of April, because I'm really thinking that something will be new phase of conflict in the next 2-3 weeks, maybe 4, because we see many of humanitarian convoys from Russia. Yeah, in 3 weeks it was about 5 of them, and that's always when there's a big, a lot of humanitarian convoys in short time, it's always something happening. Next thing probably will be some negotiations on a high level, it probably will happen something. So right now I believe that in next week something will happen, because it's still conflict going on. There's still shelling. There are fights close to Mariupol, close to Donetsk, close to Khorivka, close to Popasna, close to line of Shastaysko. Yeah, so there are many hotspots, and I believe something will happen. So first thing, I'm moving to Kyiv, and then I'm going to Donbass.
And last question: it will be war?
This one.
In Poland.
I don't know. I don't know. I hope not. I hope all war in Ukraine will end really fast, and we'll be living in love and peace, and we can forget about victims suffering again. But I don't believe this.
But then no one will care about Ukraine again. So you will be unemployed.
I think it's better than war.
Well, actually, not probably war.
Thank you very much for this meeting. And if you read in Polish, really recommend you this really good book about the situation in Ukraine right now. Thank you, Paweł.
Thank you.